Hello everyone. I am Parthasarathy from Biomics team. Welcome you all for today's session. The real difficulty is that people have no idea of what education truly is. We assess the value of education in the same manner as we assess the value of land or shares in the stock exchange market. We want to provide only such education as would enable the students to earn more. We only give any thoughts to improvement of character of the educated. The girls, we say, do not have to earn. So why should they should be educated? As long as such ideas persist, there is no hope of ever knowing the true value of education, says Mahatma Gandhi. Today's webinar on response of avian population to habitat loss is brought to you by the Biomics team. The speaker of today's webinar is an eminent resource person, Professor Q. Asoka Chakrabarty, the wildlife biologist, independent researcher, freelance journalist on environmental issues. We will be imparting advanced knowledge on the response of avian population to habitat loss. It's pride and privilege for our Biomics team in hosting this webinar with an eminent speaker. This webinar enriches you with the current knowledge of the role of birds in our ecosystem, the facts that govern birds, the rich diversity of birds, the way a bird adapts human habitat, birds' migration, birds' banding, that is ringing, and birds' trade. Welcome the challenges, look for the opportunities in every situation to learn and grow in wisdom, says Brain Tracy. I am very glad that Biomics steps up in new heights in organizing the series of webinar talks. We believe in mutual growth and development. On envisioning our motto, this webinar talks are the new initiatives on our Biomics platform. On behalf of the Biomics team, I would like to welcome our eminent resource person, Professor Q. Asoka Chakrabarty, wildlife biologist, independent researcher, freelance journalist on environmental issues. I welcome you, sir. Our speaker is an eminent scholar in the area of wildlife. Henceforth, I believe that this webinar would be nourishing the young minds in the field of climate impact on avian population. Now, I welcome Dr. Sachin, research scholar, Indian Institute of Science, IISc, Bangalore, and Vishal Kumar Shagu, who are admins of the Biomics. I cordially welcome you, both of you. And I also appreciate and welcome all the scientists, deans, professors and students from various colleges, universities and research institutes globally who joined with us through this webinar. Our eminent resource person, Professor Q. Asoka Chakrabarty, who is a wildlife biologist and an independent researcher and freelance journalist on environmental issues, has completed his MSc in Ecology and Environment from Indian Institute of Ecology and Environment, New Delhi. And he did his MPhil in Environmental Biotechnology from Bharathidasa University, Trichinopoly, Tamil Nadu. Professor Q. Asoka Chakrabarty has a rich experiences in journalism as freelance writer on environmental issues, as well as in teaching ecology and wildlife as a guest faculty in various reputed institutions across the nation. Our resource person has published several hundred articles in print media on environmental issues regarding butterflies, endangered moth species, rare moth species, kites, crab, several bird species, Brahmin mynah, lizards, snake-eyed lizard, white pea fowl, fireflies, devil tree, palm trees, sacred groves, global warming, depletion of groundwater level, conservation of wildlife, river sand exploitations, open defecation, earthquakes, landslides, and pest control, reported in various print media such as The Hindu, The New Indian Express, The Times of India, Deccan Chronicles, Daily Tandi, Dinamani, and Dinamalar Express. And Sir has also given several environmental awareness talks in All India Radio, Trichinopoly as well. Our eminent resource person has received awards internationally such as Swami Vivekananda Award from Bharati UN Kendra, Madurai, for Nature and Environmental Conservation. EOC, Yang Leaf Award from EOC Corporation Japan for our contribution of environmental conservation and protection in India. Science Journalism Award from Professor H.S. Srivastava Foundation, Lucknow at Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Such eminent resource person is with us today. Now I would like to welcome and I request our respected professors to have more insights on avian population so that the enhanced understanding could help us better to serve our wildlife and its resources through research and development in the field of conservation biology. Before that, I request the audience, if you have any questions during presentation, please start typing them into the chat box. Our team will do their best to convey your questions to the guest speaker. Sir, please.
Very good evening, friends, respected professors, students and friends. Very good evening to all. Today I have a lecture on the response of avian populations to habitat loss. Today I'd like to give a lecture on avifauna, that is avian studies ornithology. So how the avian populations are degrading their habitats. So that is the concept today. Before that, I'd like to discuss evolutionary evidence and the history of the birds. You know very well dinosaur periods also that the birds evolved from evolutionary period. The, you know very well the birds are the bipedal warm-blooded animals and vertebrates. The special character is the feathers and they lay eggs. That's why it's called oviparous. You know very well the first bird, Archaeopteryx. Archaeopteryx is a small bipedal dinosaur. The Archaeopteryx, the ability to fly, that means ability to fly, that means gliding. And Velociraptor and Oviraptor. Oviraptor and Velociraptor both are not typically bird, but bipedal, but warm-blooded, but they could not fly. So these are all the evidence we are having. And more closely related to the birds, Av metatarsalia and pterosaurs. Av metatarsalia and pterosaurs and both are pan birds and crocodiles, the very closest living relatives to the birds. And modern birds, today we have a modern birds that is a true birds that is called what you say that Neornithes, that is a crown birds. And Ornithomimicus probably the called bird. So these are all the evidence today we have a evidence, evolutionary evidence of the birds from the paleontologist. And now I discuss with you why birds concerning. Why birds? What is the bird? What are avifauna? So the, what is the role of the birds in our ecosystem? So that things we are going to discuss. And you know very well, birds they play a vital role in keeping the balance of the nature and being very important parts of the food chain and food webs. And mostly birds eat insects. That's why they are a natural way to control the pest. Most of the birds, they used to take the control the pest. That is a biological control of the pest. And now I'm going to the presentation. So now I'm having your presentations. What I am discussing with you, that's the role of the birds. You know very well, birds, they have a wonderful role in our ecosystem, particularly for that in our ecosystem. The major thing is, see that birds, they destroy the pest and pollinate flowers and disperse the seeds. These are all the very common things. And you know that birds, not only for that servicing the ecosystem, and also that very another interesting things of the seeding, not only for dispersing the seeds and pollinating, and also that scavenging carrion and cycling the nutrients and modifying the environment for other species. So these are all the things that are role in the ecosystem. And then they're maintaining the sustainable populations. They're maintaining the sustainable populations, that means not damaging the environment to the other populations. And birds are the very indicators of the environment. That means they're sensitive to the habitat change. If there is any habitat changes or any habitat disturbance, definitely bird they can sense. So the birds, if the number of the birds declining in the particular ecosystem, that means damaging the environment. So that means what? Habitat fragmentation, because there are a lot of reasons we can say habitat fragmentations, pollutions and pesticides. These are all the reasons because of anthropogenic activities. The anthropogenic activities, that means man-made causes. And the birds that play a role in helping to the controlling the agricultural pests, not only for forest ecosystem protected area, and also that birds, you could see that everywhere. That is, birds are ubiquitous everywhere. You could see from backyard to even the forest also that. So that's why they're helping controlling the agricultural pests also. And the bird urbanization, because the biggest culprit for declining of India's bird populations. Nowadays, see that in the three decades before, once the forest land converted into agricultural land, but now the agricultural land converted into the barren land. That is a real estate business. So that is a major impact on the bird populations for declining. And these are all the reasons. This is for the introductions. What is the bird and evolutionary histories? What we have discussed. And next time I'm going to discuss with you that morphology of avifauna. So just I'd like to discuss with you and how the structure of the birds and how they modified. See, the you know very well every organism their morphological structure, it adapted to the where the animals are adapted to the particular environment. So according to their structure, that would be that. And here also that, and the birds also like that. And the birds are all are a very common morphology structure, but little bit it may be the vary according to the environment. The first I like to discuss with you the beak. You know that beak is a mouth parts of the bird. It is called beak, and beaks mostly for taking the food. And the shape of the beak, it depends upon the type of the food and the type of the ecosystem. And beaks not only for helping the taking the food, and also that building the nest and preening the feathers, that is called preening. And you could see that the another slide, you could see that the different types of birds and different types of the beak, because where they adapt according to their beaks are having. The another slide, this is called sifting beak. So sifting beak, that means this is the duck, the aquatic bird. This duck has a broad beak, but the small holes on both sides. But why this is called sifting beak? Because it can sift the food from mud and water. That's why it is called sifting beak. This is the aquatic bird. And another one. Now you could see that this is also aquatic bird. Aquatic bird mostly that web-footed. So some ducks mostly that flattened beak, and some other aquatic birds, this is egret, that is a very long elongated structure. And this is called pelican bird. This is called very interesting characters of the pelican. This is a pelicaniformis. These are aquatic fish eating birds. This bird having that the gular pouch. This is a gular pouch. This is a pouch like a structure along with the throat, because this gular pouch, it can carry more than 1 kilo of the fish. When they travel for the long time and the long distance, they can carry more than 1 kilo of the fish for feeding to their young one. So this is the pelican bird. And this is also another slide for you and for explaining how the gular pouch, so very big size and capturing the whole fishes. And next one, the bird feet. The bird feet, next structure. Why the bird feet? Because the bird feet, because for the climbing, to walk, to run, to swim, and building for the nest and getting the foods. So according to their the bird feed they are having, and according to the ecosystem, and this feed is called perching feed. This perching feed helping for gripping on the branches of the trees. And next one, you could see that different types and the different shape of the feed. You could see that different size also that. And this is a this bird is called wading bird. Wading bird is a heron bird. Wading means walking on the water. And it is a woodpecker. Woodpecker having a woodpecker, very sharp claws. Very sharp claws because for climbing purpose on the bark of the trees and for gripping purpose. And see, you could see that most birds have a 4 toes. Usually the mostly 3 to 4 toes that they are having. And the first 3 toes are pointing towards, and some of the toes are pointing the backwards also. That here I am giving the example, duck and hawk and red shank and partridge. So different types of birds having different types of the feet having. And this is a wading feet. This is called wading feet because mostly the aquatic birds using the feet for helping to walk on the water. And this is the types of the feed. This is the types of the feed. You could see that. Now I have a slide with you, and four different types of the feed. First one, anisodactyl, and the second one, zygodactyl, and the third one, tridactyl, and fourth one, didactyl. The first one, anisodactyl, you see there, first 2 toes directed backwards, and the other toes, three directed the forward. And zygodactyls, the bird's feet having the 2 toes pointing forward and two backward. And tridactyl, that means having 3 feet, and didactyl having only 2 digits. These are all the feet having birds. And this feet is called webbed feet. Webbed feet mostly aquatic birds because mostly they spend most of the time in the water, so that they're helping for the swimming, mostly ducks. And this is the climbing feet because examples of the woodpecker for climbing purpose on the trunk of the trees for searching the food, not only for the searching the food and also that making the nest also that, making the hole. This is an example of the climbing feet woodpecker. This is the wading feet walking on the water. And next one, we can classify the organisms. Basically, organisms can be classified according to the food chain, according to the food habits. So here also that we can classify the birds according to the feeding diversity. You could see that the different types of the bird. And the beaks are same, but the structure that would be modifying. Some beaks are very, very short, and some beaks are curved shape, some beaks are elongated structure like that. And the feeding habitat, we can classify the birds: insectivore, granivore, nectarivore, piscivore, frugivore, carnivore, and scavengers. Like that, we can classify. Insectivores mostly used to take insects, granivores mostly take seeds. Nectarivores mostly that for taking the flowers or nectar, and piscivore mostly eat the fish, and frugivore mostly that eat the fruits, and carnivore mainly for catch and eat the other animals, and scavengers mostly used to take the dead animals. So like that, according to their food habits, we can classify the birds. And next one, some of the facts about the bird. Because very some interesting facts that birds everywhere, you could see that is ubiquitous. You could find all over the planet here, even Antarctic, Arctic, desert, Sahara, tropical America and Africa, to even the Himalayan forest and Pelagic islands. Everywhere you could see that, even from your backyard also you could see that. But birds a special character. They can tolerate extreme cold and extreme heat. That is a special characters. Even they can migrate the long distance. For example of long distance like that Arctic tern. Arctic tern actually the North Pole to South Pole the twice a year, and migrant species non-stop migrants over the sea. The best example, bobtail godwit. I saw that bottle got me during the back welding program at Point Kalinger in Tamil Nadu. I saw that many times. We have captured the bottle godwit. And some birds, they can fly even very high altitude. For example, bargeted geese. Bargeted geese, more than, they can fly 20,000 feet from the sea level. That is a special characters of the bargeted geese. And next I discuss with you that diversity of the birds. So diversity of the organisms, usually we can classify according to the ecosystem. The different types of birds, different types of organisms according to the geographical land. Like that, here I have given the example in Tamil Sangam literature. It records the 5 ecological zones. According to the ecosystem, the animal's characteristics. And for example, Marudai, Mullam, Mullai, Neidal, Palai, like that Tamil we used to say. And here the woodlands, hills, rivers, sea coasts, deserts, like that. And there are in the planet Earth, we have more than 10,000 species of the birds and 1,400 species found in South Asia, particularly in our country, India, 1,265 species and 176 endemic species are found in India and Western Ghats. And India, we have two important ecological zones, biodiversity hotspot, one in Eastern Himalaya and Western Ghats, two important biodiversity hotspot. And here Western Ghats, we have more than 12 endemic species there. And I'm going to discuss with you few birds. Not I cannot discuss all types of the all birds, but few high concern birds and common birds and some of the vulnerable and endangered birds I like to discuss with you. And first one, what you see, that very common bird, what is called pond heron. Simply we used to say pond heron. Ardelia grayi, very common bird. Everywhere, every waterhole you could find. And mainly feeds fishes, frogs, aquatic insects. And very interesting things, during the breeding season, very attractive golden plumage you could see that. Tamil, we used to say that Marayan birds, because they are not caring about what they are surrounding that. Just for only concentrating the fishing only that. That's why it's called Marayan. But simply we used to say the stupid bird. So often it would be entangled from the hunters. And another one, Indian chicka. Very interesting. Lagudu, we used to say. Acipiter badius. Even in our college campus also, you could see that. One of the very common birds of prey. And in countrysides and forests also, you could see. And they feed mostly small birds and lizards and frogs. And the special characters hunting. There is a hunter. Even though they can hunt, even the mid-deer also they can hunt. This is a special character of the Indian chikra. And next to one, crested serpent eagle. Spilornis is a chila, one of the huge birds of prey, and mostly a well-wooded forest. And special characters killing the reptiles, even the snake, even the large reptiles. And special characters of building a huge nest on big trees also that. So this is the characters of the crescent serpent eagle. And very beautiful bird, water bird, aquatic bird, white-breasted water hen. Amaranthus phoenicurus, very common bird. And mostly you could find marshes, swamps, you could find. And this chorus sound during the breeding season, you could find. But they have a long legs, elongated legs and fingers also having. That it helped to floating on the water and vegetation. Another very significant bird in agriculture, particularly agriculture. This is a Tritalba barnow. The face that would be very similar to heart shape and a very snowy white. This white is not a common white, very snowy white. Widespread throughout the world, except Antarctica. And what is the speciality of this bird? This is called rodent hunter. 90% of the food, the samples, the fecal matter it contains, 90% of the mice, that is a rodent, a very common bird. You see there, barn owls, that is a Tritalba, is a scientific name. Tito, that is a Greek meaning. Actually, that meaning is called night. Alba means white. This is a nocturnal creature. This is a nocturnal creatures. Naturally born the predators. Mostly it can hunt at night. Very keen night vision. For example, see, very special important things. An average night, one night, the owl can eat up 12 rodents. They can hunt 12 rodents. That is a special characters. The barn owl actually the sociable and even hunt the small groups of the rodent populations, not only the rodents, and also controlling the pest. In some small barn owl, they can control the squirrel, they can hunt the rabbit, even the they can control the small pest also there. So barn owl and along with the rodent, the snowy white, you could see that the white patch is the white color, the snowy white. It's a very beautiful point, beautiful boss. This is another photographs barn owl. And this is called Indian roller. Indian roller, very common bird. You could see there even in your country sites. Very important, common bird, but they can control the pest. They can hunt the insects. It's an insect controller. This is another bird, Indian cuckoo, upapa pops. Actually, once it was very common bird in countryside. In countryside, I'm talking the village side. You know, a decade or 2 decades before that, I saw that mostly you could find the Indian cuckoo. But now this bird, common bird, that it would become a rare bird. I usually see once in a year. Every year I used to see that June, July, August, like that. I used to see only one bird, only that. But a forest area maybe that, but the countryside, the populations. So much the population is declining. This is the cattle egrets, very common bird. Agriculture land, ploughing. During the ploughing in agriculture cultivated land, you could see that. And the yellow color, orange bill. Very insect controller, very important. Insect control in common bird. And this is called greater cockle. Center of sinensis, we used to say. Cockle bird, crow pheasant. Simply, we used to say English name. Crow pheasants, the sound, you know, that something is a different, you know, that the sound voice is of the crow pheasant, like this kind of the sign. So a huge voice they produce. From the voice you could identify this is the crow pheasant. It's a very strong voice and effective hunter, and mostly that they can hunt lizards, rats, frogs, like that. And this is a cuckoo family, this is a member of the cuckoo family. And another interesting bird, coppersmith, Megalomia hemicephala. Actually, this coppersmith bird, this voice also, this is also interesting one. The voice, it would be like that. Troop, continuously, it makes the sound like this. Troop, like this. So very common bird. Every garden, woodland area, you could find. And a typical call. This I told that. I made it a very typical call. This typical call, troop, like that. Mostly the feed, especially fruits, they used to take. Tricky word bird. And another one, white-throated kingfisher. The white-throated kingfisher mostly, wherever the water bodies, streams, and you could find that. Mostly that feed fishes, insects, and water insects, and lizards, frogs, like that, they used to take. But brilliant color. And they used to patiently wait for taking the prey. That is a special characters of the kingfisher. This is called insect bug. This is called bee eater. Mostly they used to take bees. That's why it's called bee eater. Mostly they used to take honeybees, wasps, dragonflies. Mostly you could find the roadside. Roadside, if there is electric pole, you could electric wire, you could find that. With a brilliant color and the head, you could see that there are three or four parts, you could find that. They live in a very small flock, and mostly it is a solitary animal. Only one, single only, you could find that. Another one, Asian palm sift. Sift, simply we used to say that. Before rain, you could find. Before rain, I think minimum one flock you could find 50 palm sift you could find before half an hour before you could find. Then this is indicating that means the rain will come. So mostly it can nest the palmyra palms, highly depend on palm trees. Mostly they used to take even this is aerial hunter, they used to hunt in the mid air also, they could hunt. And this is a long tailed strike. the strike bird. What is the special character? This is called butcher bird. Why butcher bird? Because after taking the food, after the dead parts of the body of the organism, they used to hung on the remaining parts of the thorny bushes. That's why it's called butcher bird. This is a very special character. And jungle babbler. Jungle babbler, simply we used to say that seven sister. Mostly a group, you could find seven to nine birds you could find. That's why it's called seven sister. Jungle bird, common bird, common jungle babbler that. Common babbler you could find a village site, but jungle babbler only the forest area you could find. And this is a bulbul bird. Red-vented bulbul, red-whiskered bulbul. Red-whiskered bulbul, along with the head, you could find the red color patches. This is a red-vented bull. The voice, you know, that very beautiful voice. Like this kind of the voice they used to produce. Very common bird, very wooded, moist area you could find. And beautiful bird. This is a sunbird. Simply, we used to say sunbird. Nectaronia xylonica, particularly this is a purple rumped sunbird, beautiful birds of India, everywhere, wherever the flowers there, you could find. This is a very good example of the pollinators. And one of the smallest birds of India, flower pecker. This is a thick-billed flower pecker, very active and very important factor forest ecosystem and pollinating flowering plants. Very smallest bird in India. And a magpie robin, robin kuruvi, simply we used to say oriental magpie robin. A songster bird, this is called a songster birds of India. Mostly they prefer, even village side also you could see that. But the melodious song, where the usually organisms, animals and birds, mostly all male birds very beautiful. All male birds are very beautiful. This robin, oriental magpie robin, male sings a melodious song during the breeding season. That is a special character. And the rocket-tailed drango, you know very well, you see that. Because of racket-sized tail. That's why it is called racket-tailed drango. Commonly found mostly high elevated, at least minimum 500 meter to minimum 500 meter elevated for hilly area you could find. Very famous mimicking, it can mimic different calls and confusing to the bird watchers. And they can steal the food from other birds also and mimic the predator's call. That's why sometimes the bird watchers confusing from this bird. Another picture, Pachycephalus drango. This is another picture. This is another one is a rufous tree pipe, very common bird. Everywhere you could find, in your village side also you could find. The tail is a very beautiful, long tail, and the voice also very beautiful one. This is a rufous tree pipe, very common bird. And this is a osprey mostly found in the coastal area. Osprey mostly raptor, we used to say raptor, mostly coastal sites and then aquatic system you could find, mostly the special hunter of the fishes. And this is a snake bird. Simply we used to say snake bird, darter we used to say. The special characters of the bird, the long thin neck. It looks like a snake appearance. That's why it is called snake bird. Mostly that all aquatic ecosystem you could find. Very common common bird. And there are four species of the worldwide snake bird. Another super character that is called, what is it, that bargeted geese. Simply we used to say bargeted goose. This bargeted is, it is called ducks. Mostly that you could see that this bird having the web footed and excellent special character. They can fly in a high altitude. That is a special character. Bargeted geese can even fly 24,000 feet. Even the Mount Everest, 24,000 feet. Why? Because they have a special features of the large lungs, and that large lungs having the dense network of the blood vessels. That's why they can fly even the long feet also that. And why? Because this bird having the hemoglobin in their blood in a high amount of the oxygen. That's why it can fly in high altitude. And also that they have a more mitochondria. That's why if any organisms needs more energy, they need more mitochondria. Mitochondria is a powerhouse of the cell. That's why it allows the most breath of the oxygen. Even some birds also having the richer oxygen. So that's why this barred-headed geese can fly even the 24,000 feet high altitude. This is a special characteristic of the barred-headed geese. So another picture, the single bird. I have recorded the barred-headed geese in the Tamil Nadu Point Calimber also there. And then nearby Tiruchirappalli, there is a place or sanctuary there also that you could find this bird. This is another photographs, barred-headed geese. This is during the migration, during the flying. And another one, a Siberian crane. This is called white crane, simply we used to say. Cranes, this is also very tall bird. Mostly you could find in Bharatpur, Rajasthan, you could find that. This is another picture. This is another picture, Siberian crane. Mostly that Rajasthan and Haryana, those belt you could find, Northern India, you could find this bird. It is another long, elongated structure, legs that is called black-winged stilt. Stilt, simply we used to say, a very long legged wader bird, wader, simply we used to say wader, a regular migrant to India. Usually, they have five subspecies there. And breeding habitat almost shallow water and ponds and wetlands. Those aquatic ecosystem you could find this bird. This is another picture of the stilt. And now I am going to show you high conservative, according to the India's bird report, India's state of the bird 2020. They have listed, these are all the birds are high concerned bird. One not one species are high concerned bird. This is a Nilgiri pipit. This Nilgiri pipit mostly you could find in the Western Ghats. You could see that only in Western Ghats. And this is a common green shag, Dringa nebularia. Dringa nebularia mostly you could find in the Point Calimber in Tamil Nadu. And this is called green munia. High concern bird. This is a Narcondom hornbill. Only you could find that Andaman Islands, you could find that. And this is the Nilgiri laughing thrush. That Nilgiri laughing thrush, this is endemic to the western parts. And this is a Indian parakeets. It's a most vulnerable species. Mostly the bird trade. Everywhere you could see there, every villages, you could find the trapping this bird, the parakeet. This is a plum-headed parakeet. And this is the paradise flycatcher, female bird. This is another picture, paradise flycatcher, female bird. This is a flamingo bird, flamingo. This is a common goot, simply we used to say, namakoli we used to say, aquatic bird. So these are all the birds are a high concern bird according to the state of India's bird 2020. And now I'm focusing, now I have discussed with you that what are birds and evolutionary evidence and then structure of the birds. And some I have discussed with you some common birds and then high concern birds and vulnerable species I have discussed with you. And I have done two studies, one in Tamil Nadu, Tiruchirappalli. And one more studies from at Calcutta. Two studies I have done. How birds becoming to adapt the human habitats. So that is the concept. The first one I discussed with you. How two I have taken the two birds. One is a scaly breasted munia. Another bird Indian silverbill. Two birds I have taken in Tamil Nadu here. The how bird the nest habitat modified in Tamil Nadu study. Nearby, I have taken the three samples, one from Tiruchirappalli and Perambalur, and three area I have taken the sample, because the three area I have studied, and here ecological environment changes, due to changes of the environment, the avian diversity, they are getting depleted natural food. That's why they are losing their home forest and making the nest in human settlement. So that is my study. And here I have taken the spotted munia, that is a scaly breasted munia, Lanchura punctulata. This species resembles very sparrow size and biologically sparrow and Munia, but different species of birds. And scaly-breasted Munia, the name suggests because of scaly structure on the breast. And body of adults is brown color and dark brown color than the female one. And habitat loss, here I have the result. The habitat loss poses the greatest threat species, not only for the birds and also butterflies, insects, and snakes also that. And once the forest lands, I told that before my lecture, I told that. And once the forest land converted into agricultural land, but now the agricultural land converted into the barren land, that is the real estate business. So that's why they are not only, and also that the wide expanding road also that. You know that in Calcutta, from the Shambajar to Barakpur, that the Shambajar, Pitirmore, Dunlop, Panigati, those belt, you could see there. 5 years back, I saw that there were a lot of trees that along the roadside. But now, due to the construction of the metro train, entire area the trees were felled down. And even I have studied many birds that built the nest and they lost their habitat. So these are all the reasons, anthropogenic activities, it causes to fragmentation of the natural home of the birds. That's the reason. And there have been a lot of changes in the physical environment that I have mentioned in Calcutta also that, and here also that, Trichy, Perambalur, Ayyur, those areas, there are a lot of changes there. And my study on birds ecology, last 10 years in our locality, the major ecological factors that is responsible for the population crashes, because if there is no home, that means if there is no forest, if there is no habitat, there will be no food. So if there will be no food, there will be no organism. So that is the concept. And not only that, the anthropogenic activities, and also that natural factors like climate changes, or global warming. These are all the things are impact on the birds also that. And best example I can give you, you know that the firefly, once it was very common insects, but today is a very rare to see the rural localities. So this is one example. And this bird, scaly-breasted Munia, spotted Munia. This is the scaly-breasted Munia nest I have taken at Vepur. Vepur, actually Tamil Nadu, from Tiruchirappalli to Chennai Road, after Perambalur, you could see there is a, beside the road, I saw that. Very noisy area, I saw that they constructed. Usually the scaly-breasted Munia, they make the nest, tawny bushes and a thick jungle. But it made a nest beside the road. You see that, it's a fully nest. Yeah, you see that, I have taken at Vepur by Chennai bypass road before rain. Before rain, I saw that seven eggs were there. But after rain, what happened? You see that this is a fully grown nest covered. And see that bird nest at Vepur before rain. Before rain, you see that how it was so nice. And after that, you see that the after rain eggs were fragile. Why? Because the scaly-breasted Munia was built the nest low canopy. That's why it was fragile. That is the reason. See that before rain, seven eggs were there, but now see that only 3 eggs were there. Yeah, another bird, Indian silver bill. Actually, we used to say white-throated Munia. Actually, the near Trichirappalli, the place is called Manachanallu. Very noisy area beside the road. It was on my hand. In my home, it was built a nest. Then I rescued. After the felling down, I rescued and I just dropped into the nearby forest. Usually, it prefer for open scrub, open area. Open area means open forest. But it was a build a nest on my balcony. So it was on my hand, the chick. Yeah, this is the fully grown the nest. Yeah, now I'm going to the, when I was in Calcutta, I did a study nearby Sodhpur. This is a bioweaver nest. You see that bioweaver nest. See that see one study I did in Tamil Nadu and another study in Calcutta. See that another one, bioweaver nest. Yeah, bioweaver nest. Yeah, I have taken this photograph. One, two. See bioweaver nest nearby Sotpur. I have taken. Yeah, bioweaver nest on my hand. Just it was fell down and then I took it and I kept at the bank of the tree. Because after see very special things I like to mention. See bioweaver nest with clay soil. Why? See after taking the nest, I searched. I saw that clay soil. Why they put the clay soil? Because they put the watery clay soil for sticking the firefly. Because during the night time they put the stick the firefly because it emit the light. That light it will help to the young ones. That's what that is the reason it is sticking the firefly on the nest. Yeah, you see that clay soil. You see that. Next one, woodpecker. This is a woodpecker made of hole in Calcutta. Yeah, this is an Asian pied myna. Only you could find the West Bengal, those belt you could find the pied myna. It's a pied myna. Yeah. Cormorant and beetle root. This is a very interesting thing. Usually, cormorant, mostly you could find aquatic ecosystem, water. But beside the beetle root, there was a tree, large tree. It made it made a nest, and also that I saw that mostly more than 10 cormorants I saw that beetle root. So another one, beetle root, same nest, not only cormorant and also including the night heron also that. You see that night heron. See that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more than 10. I have taken the photographs. Yeah, you could see that. Very busy road. BT road is a very busy road. Yeah, you see that. This road. This BT road. Sham Bazaar, then Titir Mor, and Dunlop, like this. Panigati, Titagar, then Barakpur, that belt, BT road. Yeah, BT road in Calcutta. And beside the road, there was your electric pole, a bird constructed nest. I think the crow nest, I think, exactly, I don't know. And next topic, what is migration? Why do birds migrate? Because usually migration happening a regular movement of animals from one place to another place, that is called migrations. Because the reason for the migrations, sustained movement, physical endurance, mechanism, strong energy. Before very interesting thing, before migration, birds usually take to fatty food and store the fatty into the body, and that fatty food that would be converted into the fuel, so that it gives to energy to the bird to fly long distance. That is the reason. So migrant species, we classified in India, resident 206, long distance migrant 36, within subcontinent 19 species. And long distance migrant like that, forest black tail, Pacific golden plover, and common green shank, and subcontinent migrant that also like common pochard, rosy starling, and rose finch, and red-breasted flycatcher, and bar-bedded geese. So these are all the birds are subcontinent migrant species. And why do birds migrate? Because these are all the reasons, because of food, and because of the own breed and different places, and protect their young ones, and get away from the predators, and avoiding the disease, and avoiding the climate factors. These are all the reasons of birds are migrating. And other things, and how we study the migrations, migrating birds, how we study, because there is a system is that, and that is called bird banding, that is a bird ringing, that is we used to trap the, that means catch the bird and ring the bird. Ring the bird and then mention the location and mention the country and mention the organization name, and releasing into the where we caught the bird, we release the bird, and through this bird ringing we can study the bird migration. The India's leading organization, pioneering organization, Bombay National Institute Society. I have been trained by BNHS bird banding program, and also that nowadays the Wildlife Institute of India, and these are all the organizations are doing the bird ringing, bird banding program. And what are the challenge? What are the challenge for threat to the migrating species? Because there are the reasons that because of climate factors, maybe cold weather, maybe for hot weather, maybe for drought, maybe no water, and another dangerous for human hunting. So these are all the challenges threat to the migrating birds. And the climate factors also impact the migration. That is the last 2 decades of climate changes that is impact to the migratory species. And migratory birds usually they increase their body mass increase, that would be increasing 70 to 80%. As I told before, that before taking the migration they used to take a fatty food and they gain the weight. That fat that would be deposited under the skin, that fat that would be converted into the fuel, so that it can help to the bird fly for the migration even the high altitude. So this is the bargainer geese, or you see that high oxygen affinity. And the flamingo migration, this is the flamingo migrations. Now you see that flamingo migration, this is a flock of birds migrating, this photograph showing you. And usually when they take the migration, usually birds fly V shape. Usually you could see that whenever you have a chance to see the birds, when they fly in a single flock, they used to fly like this V shape. And I told that the bird banding, through the bird banding, we could get the birds how they are migrating. So this is, we used to say that ringing. Usually the bird ringing, that is a banding. In India, we have aluminium metal. We are using aluminium metal mostly. 90% we are using aluminium metal. And now we are using the telemetry project. Telemetry project means a small chip we can attach the bird under the wings, and it can be connected to the computer, and we can monitoring the bird through the telemetry. So that is now new methods. And before that we used aluminium metal. And after the ringing the bird, we examine feather mold, fat, age, and sex. And during the capture, we used to study these are all the things. After ringing, then we release the bird where we caught. That is a very important thing. So this is a methodology. What I have said, this methodology we are following. So this is a bird banding. You see that? You take a look. A small ring. Usually attaching the left leg, attaching the left leg, you see that very small, but it won't disturb the bird. You see that bird banding. That is the foreign countries mostly they use the plastic ring. In our country we use the aluminium metal. Yeah, you see that aluminium metal left side in our country, and this is the other country. Yeah, you see that? Sorry, you see that? Take a look. Another one. Yeah, this way we used to ring the bird. Yeah, this way we can ring the bird. Yeah, take a look. This is a small bird. Small birds having we used to put a very small size of the ring. And what are the threats? What are the threats of the birds in our country? In our country, we have a lot of threats to the birds. For example, there are the 4 important things we have to discuss threatened to the birds. And one is the habitat loss, that is habitat destruction, expansion of the agricultural land, and rapid industrialization, and hunting, and also trade. And natural factors, that is a global warming and climate changes. So these are all the factors affecting the birds. And this is the photograph I have taken at Trichinopoly. This is a bird trade. Bird trade also that affecting the bird populations. This is the NSB road. In this cage, Munia and parakeet species were there. I saw there a person who was selling the birds, and one bird, one parakeet rupees, 200 rupees, one parakeet, and Munia per pair 500 rupees. Even sometimes the parakeet 1000 rupees also per pair. And other problems, the pesticide, and left side myself and the right side farmers. Pesticides is another problem for the birds populations. Mostly the farmers, this farmer used to mostly that fungicides, this pest, and organophosphorus is a major culprit to destroying the bird population. And this is the birds fungicide, pesticide using nearby Pachamalai. In nearby Pachamalai, this is the location from the Tiruchirappalli, Tamil Nadu. And another problem, roadkill. I have taken the photographs. And nearby Tiruchirappalli and Tiruchirappalli Thiroyur Road. Roadkill are another problem for local birds. That means common birds. Common birds, major problem, roadkill. Because road fragmentation, the habitat fragmentation, mostly they used to travel from one place to another place, and mostly they used to kill by run over by the vehicle. Mostly two wheelers. This is another problem, roadkill. And I have published even in Kokal, Propesence. I have published the Hindu Tamil, the Propesence run over by vehicles. That is the story I have published in Tamil newspaper, Hindu newspaper. And another problem, illegal bird trade. International level parakeet species, black-headed munia, red munia, and hill myna. And these are all the species are internationally trading. And wild Indian birds demand for international markets, because after catching the bird, they put the new color, the not original color. They put the bird that would be disguising. The bird would get the new color, and they can sell the bird. This is a new bird like that. They are selling like this. And another things we can classify according to the threatens. We can classify, very well, extinct, what is extinct, what is critically endangered, what is endangered, vulnerable, near threatened, least concern. So this is for the categorically we can classify the birds. And the State of India's Birds Report 2020, according to that, the report was released the 17th February. Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India. Actually, what the report says, 52% of Indian avifauna also declining. It trends with the 101 species, high classified species, that is a high conservation concern, and 79 species have been declining. 79 species have been declining because the last 5 years, the birds have been declining. Why? Because of the habitat fragmentation. Because of the habitat fragmentation. And 300 species. India, we have critically endangered 12, endangered 15, vulnerable 40, near threatened 8. And this is a white-backed vulture. These are all the species what I am going to show you. All are high concern and vulnerable species. This is the white-backed vulture and long-billed vulture. And Jordan cursor, actually, is a very sad news. Actually, the endemic species only found in Andhra Pradesh, southeastern Andhra Pradesh. Actually, the central region, Godavari River Basin, you could find. But this habitat specialist bird found only in those area, only that. And now the numbers so declining. That is a very saddest news. And the forest also that. That is the same thing. All are the number that would be so decreasing because of habitat destruction. The number that would be very least number. And endangered species, we have 15 birds there. Endangered species. The great Indian bustard. The great Indian bustard, actually, that historically, why the number that would be decreasing? Because of hunting. Because of most hunting. Mostly, those areas you could find Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Karnataka, those Madhya Pradesh, those places you could find because of expansion of agriculture and habitat fragmentation, pesticides. These are all the reasons the great Indian bustards, the populations have been declining. And bustard family, there are the four important birds there. Great Indian bustard, Mackin's bustard, Lesser Florican, Bengal Florican, all are suffering, continuously suffering because of hunting and habitat loss. What the BNHS people are telling like that, 90% of populations of bustard family declining. That is a very sad news. And we have 40 species of vulnerable species. And a few only I would like to discuss. This is a spot-billed pelican bird. This is also, and Sarah's crane also that I discussed earlier. This is Sarah's crane bird. Sarah's crane. Actually, very special, interesting thing, Sarah's crane. This bird only, they can mate, only one female mate the entire life. That is a very special character. And usually not India, if there is any husband and wife, the problem, the panchayat man, the sarpanch usually that direct the couples to visit the one day to the Sarah's crane. That is a punishment. And it's a painted stock. The lesser flamingo. And another thing I must discuss with you, the sparrow. You know very well the sparrow nowadays, because of media, sparrows are focusing even the common people. That is the common people. But according to the State of India's bird, what they say, the sparrow population, somewhat the population increasing, but not all metropolitan cities, only increasing in the countryside, that is the village rural pockets. The sparrow mostly they used to take grains, seeds, corn, these kind of the these insects, this kind of the food they usually take. And aerial hunter also, that the insect populations decreasing because of pesticide insect population decreasing, that's why sparrow populations also declining. That is a major reason. And these are sparrows of India: Russet sparrow, house sparrow, Eurasian sin sparrow, Spanish sparrow. This is the, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sparrow species there. World Sparrow Day, 20th March 2000, every year we used to celebrate the World House Sparrow Day, 20th March. And I'm going to conclude why we need birds, why we have to conserve the birds, because there are a lot of reasons I discussed with you, and controlling the pests, pollinating plants, and transforming the entire landscape. So birds are considered forest engineer. Birds are considered forest engineer. Why? Because the best example, hornbill. In thick jungle, the hornbill, the dispersing the seeds. So they construct the different types of the trees. That's why all the birds are considered engineers of the forest. And the birds play important role in maintaining the ecological balance. And now the dwindling the numbers, because that is indicating natural devastating that danger to the every country. And birds consider the keystone species and indicating the ecosystem. So it is considered the integral to the humans. That's why, so not only the birds, and also that we have to protect the coexisting organisms like butterflies, moth, and lizards. And the coexistence organisms also, that is very important to conserve and protect in the ecosystem. And thank you. Jai Hind.
Hello. Sir, is audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. Your presentation is quite interesting and so informative. Yeah. Your knowledge fascinates the field of wildlife and avian population. Sir, today we had an enthusiastic participant throughout this webinar. And the questions are really interesting. Now I will forward the questions one by one from my participants to you. Okay.
Yes, welcome. Tell me.
Yes. Dr. Kumaresan was asking that how do birds in a flock decide the pattern of murmuration and flight sequence during migration?
Pardon, pardon, once again.
How do birds in a flock decide the pattern of murmuration and flight sequence during migration?
Actually, the migration still is confusing. According to the ornithologists, the migration pattern that still is kind of, some scientists, they are saying that according to the moon, they can migrate. Some scientists, they are saying that according to the sun. So the migration patterns of the birds still is confusing. That's why today the modern technology, the scientists, they are using the telemetry methods. They are finding out, still they are finding out the techniques and how they are finding out the how the birds are migrating and what is the reason. Those kind of the things still they are doing research through the telemetry project.
Okay, sir. And Baswaraj is asking that nowadays birds taking food from dumping yards. Is there any harmful to these birds?
Yeah, definitely, certainly, because a dumping yard, I think the mostly waste, household waste. Definitely, there would be bacteria, there would be maybe for some virus, that it can affect the bodies of the birds. Definitely, it can impact to the bird. There may be, that is a best example I can say. The vulture, what happened to the vulture? The vulture mostly, they used to take a dump yard, the carrions, dead animals, because the diclofenac. Like that, the dumping area, bird, whatever they need to take that, definitely it can affect to the birds. There is no doubt.
Yes. Sir, next question is from Sushmita. Is there any changes in bird population due to the COVID-19 situation, like the sky and the marine systems?
No. There is no report like that. The COVID-19 only for the virus, mostly it affected the report we have, only it affected the humans, but we don't have any report affected impact to the organism. We don't have any report.
Yes. The next question is from Abdullah. What type of migration does this bird follow?
Yeah, I told that bird migration still is a confusing one. Still is a misery. Still is something astonishing the scientist. Some birds they travel according to the moon. Some birds they can travel night time. Some birds they can travel the diurnal time. Some birds traveling the nocturnal time according to the moon, according to the sunlight. So. Like that, the bird usually travel. That is a migratory.
Okay. Next question is from Rahul Mujinder. What is endocrine disruption?
Endocrine. That is a hormonal. Endocrine is the study of the hormone. What is the question? Endocrine disruption means what? Endocrine.
Yes. What is endocrine disruption?
Endocrine disruption, hormonal imbalance.
Okay. And next question is from Rogini. How the birds feel the various changes in the environment? Do they migrate even in the place they are migrating to, any place which has different climate than the usual one?
That means how they sensitive.
Yes.
But that's why the birds are called indicators of the environment. There is any changes. Any changes means I am talking anthropogenic activities. For example, the natural area, the natural habitat. If there is any changes, for example, pesticide using. See, pesticides only in cultivated land. Yeah, of course, there is no doubt. The cultivated land, it can they spray the pesticides that it can affect through, it can travel through the air, that it can affect the nearby forest area, nearby water bodies, that it can affect. So definitely, if there is a water hole, but the water bodies that would be contaminated, polluted by pesticides. So definitely, but they can sense. So this is one example. We can say like that.
Yes. Next question is from Zyber Menon. How long does the bird flight during migration?
How long? That I told the market degrees. Like, each and every bird not a same altitude. I mentioned that the market geese they fly high altitude Even the Mount Everest, 23 feet. In some birds, not in all birds, the same 23 feet. But some birds, they travel low altitude. Some birds, they travel 1,000 meters, like that they can travel.
Okay.
According to the body structure. See, 150 gram, a small bird, it traveled 22,000 kilometers.
Wow.
It's very surprising. So 150 or yes. 250 grams weight. We weighed 250 grams, but it traveled from other country, 22,000 kilometers. So body weight, because of the reason, before migration, they used to take a fatty food. That fatty food that deposited under the skin, that food that would be converted into the fuel. So different types of the bird, different altitude, it can fly.
Okay, sir. Dr. Kumaresh is asking that how does night light affect the migratory birds?
Definitely. For example, if they cross the border, it can change. The night light, it would be confusing the direction. It would be confusing the direction to the bird. Definitely. Night light, definitely it would be affected. There is no doubt. Suppose if the bird comes to towards the city or town area, definitely it would be confusing. It would affect. There is
yes.
no doubt.
Okay, sir. Mohammed is asking that what about the gene flow in birds?
Gene flow. That is a gene flow. I don't know. What he is asking, I don't know. Gene flow means what? Gene flow birds. That is this is kind
of. It is genetic aspects, I think.
Genetic aspects. Yes, that yes, is, yes. There is a gene flow. I don't know. Genetics part.
Okay, sir. Our next question is from Christiana from Chennai. Can the sparrow population can be increased in Tamil Nadu?
No, particularly we cannot say. But according to the India State of Birds 2020, sparrow population somewhat stability only in rural pocket. Rural pocket only the population is maintaining, but not in metropolitan city. But the population is maintaining, stable. But people are telling that, but there is no scientific evidence. Cell phone tower, it may cause us to the sparrow population, but no evidence. Scientifically, we don't have evidence. But the population is still stable condition. But only in rural part, not metropolitan city.
Okay, sir. And Vishal Kumar is asking that, is there any difference due to network tower or mobile towers in migration patterns of the bird?
That I told that. There is no evidence. There is no proper evidence. Electromagnetic waves that may cause or might cause, but we don't have it. That may not affect the migration because migratory birds mostly they travel high altitude, not low altitude. If they travel low altitude, that's also not affect. But the windmill may affect the migratory birds.
Yes.
Yeah.
Then next question is from Bhaswaraj. Like, sparrows are disappointed even in villages. Also, what is the reason behind this?
Yes. If the sparrow population decreasing in village, according to my study, I did a study, not sparrow, but I did a study all common birds in villages because of pesticides. The pesticide is a real culprit to decline in the numbers of the bird. That is a major reason.
Yes. The next question is from Amar Singh. What is the source of this information? And the follow-up question is, how the adverse effect on avian population due to the habitat loss can be minimized?
How do you minimize the habitat loss?
Yes.
That is the question. Habitat loss, if you minimize, I'm talking natural forest area, that is a protected area. Protected area that should be maintaining the tree population and vegetation. That would be maintaining the vegetation. And the rural pocket and the town areas and the cities, but we have to plant more trees. We should not disturb the trees, even the common small trees. If you disturb the trees, I mentioned, best example I can say, nowadays in southern India, the palm trees are totally wiped out. You know, Baya, we were mostly depend on palm trees.
Yes.
Depend on the palm trees. But where are the palm trees? Nowadays, the palm trees are declining the number in southern India. And even I mentioned, I saw that in Calcutta, from Shyam Bazaar to Barakpur Road, Beat Road, very lengthy road. And those times, 5 years back, 2008, like that, those period, I used to often go there. But nowadays, once there were a huge population, the tree population. But today, because of metro train, they totally fell down the tree. That is what affects the bird population. Definitely.
Okay, sir. So the next question, is there any regulation established by the central government in this regard?
No, but the government of India should take necessary steps to protect the trees. If they protect the trees, definitely these are all called ignoring species. Ignoring species, that means birds, butterflies, lizards, moth, all are microfauna, ignoring species. Nobody concerning. Only they are concerning gigantic species, tiger, leopard. Of course, there may be tiger, leopard, elephant. We must concern. There is no doubt. At least we have to take care of all these kind of the little creatures. That's also they play a vital role in our ecosystem. That's why Government of India should take necessary steps to protect the common trees in India. If they protect, definitely these ignoring species escape from the habitat loss.
Okay, sir. So the most interesting question is that it is asked by Meta, why they fly in V-shape during migration? Why birds fly in V-shape during migration?
You know that flight. You know that flight. The flight, the forward part, the flight, the forward and backward. The first forward part is the V-shape. So birds naturally, instinct, who taught to the birds, nobody knows. But the bird, their own natural habits, natural way, they make the V shape, because if they make the V shape, they can tear the air and they can fly properly without disturbing air. That's why they can fly the V shape. Who taught? We don't know. But birds have such a knowledgeable organism. That's why we used to say all the organisms, they have a good knowledge rather human being. But we may think we are the knowledgeable, but nature, we cannot conquer the nature. So nature talent, we have to learn many things from the nature. That's why in Tamil there is a proverb, Vimanam Padaitan, they used to say that. We saw the flight, we saw the bird. We invented flight. That is the reason.
Yes. The last question is from Nilesh. He is asking that here in Kolkata, I am seeing that he is seeing a lot of black kites recently. Can you tell the reason behind this?
Because maybe for the only particularly the black kite. Black kite usually black kite is very commonly coexisting human habit. But if there are any dumping places, waste material and throwing the fishes, meat from the butcher shop, because of these reasons, black kite may be that. That is the reason may be that.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your questions and answer sessions. I hope all the participants, those who raised their questions, have filled with the knowledge and answers for those questions. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, 1 minute. I would like to send my thanks to organizing the Miami, and particularly Mr. Parthasarathy, Mr. Karthik, and who has giving me a wonderful opportunity to sharing my knowledge about the birds. And I also thank to all the participants. I'm not an expert, but I'm also learners. I sincere thanks to all participants and organizing committee. And once again, I sincere thanks to Mr. Parthasarathy and Karthik and Biomix teams. Thank you so much. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.